Welcome everybody. This is the last step of this evening session. And we turned after our meeting of the society to English language because the standard language of any scientific meeting. And obviously it's a great pleasure and honor that Giorgio accepted to be here, not in presence, but at least to speak with all of us, to provide us his point of view about our discipline. Thank you, Giorgio, for accepting our interviews.
Thank you to everybody. Sorry, there's a small problem. I cannot share my screen. Well, I can start to speak, but if you, the screen. Okay, thank you. Thank you. You see the screen?
Yes, we see it.
Okay, I don't see it, but I will. Okay. Okay, you see multiple equilibria, I guess. Okay, so it's fine this way?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so one of the subjects that I would like to speak of is essence and multiple equilibrio. Now, the idea of the talk will be multiple equilibrium, starting with multiple equilibrium in natural science. I will discuss what spin glasses are. In multiple equilibria, I would stress that multiple equilibria discovered theoretically in spin glasses. I will discuss some of the experimental tests of multiple equilibria. After, I would refine this idea, looking to off equilibrium fluctuation dissipation, essentially what people call the Coulliand-Lacourchian relations, and experimental and numerical test of these relations. Now, I would start from long time ago, nearly 50 years ago, in this case 50 years ago, Eldredge and Gould proposed the evolutionary theory of punctuated equilibria. The idea of these two gentlemen was that the evolution of the species is not a continuous gradual process, but there are long periods of stasis, and during the stasis there is no change in the morphology. What at the level of genotype, you can have a series of variation, but you don't have at the level of phenotype. Now, if you look to the phenotype is important because of what is what we see in if we do look to the rest. This period of stasis are punctuated by rare bursts of evolution and change. It's something like that we say the species is from some viewpoint. In some minimum, the phenotype, if you want, is some minimum of fitness landscape, and one goes from one fitness landscape to another fitness landscape, not via gradual evolution, but crossing a region of not so good fitness, and therefore you have something like a very fast change, like tunnel event. Now, in modern theory of memory that start from Hebe, after it was the work of Littre, Hopfield, Daniel Amit, the part of the brain that is responsible for the memory may stay in extremely large number of equilibrium state, each corresponding to recalling of a different item, and may remain in that situation for a long period. Hebe itself has this idea that the memory remains for a long time in one equilibrium state, and it's clear just because we can recall so many things, the number of equilibrium state should be extremely high. Okay. Now, in other science, we see the same phenomena. For example, that we have a period of equilibrium separated by fast transition to an equilibrium state. For example, you can look to single ecosystem, you can look in climate, glaciation, you have a geological era, but also you have animal behavior and so on and so on. And from the side view of physics, similar idea have been put forward by Goldstein in 69 to understand the physics of glass. That also he believed that glass at low temperature explore the phase space mainly to activate jumps between different amorphous minima that are separated by some potential energy barrier. Okay. Now, this is essentially what you can call an artist's view of a, oh my God, of a corrugated landscape. Is everything is okay? Okay. And the possible movement. A possible movement of this environment. Okay, now the thing that moved the whole subject was something that was completely unrelated. It was the first clear sign of a transition in a metallic spin glasses. Now, metallic spin glasses are some alloys for example, gold with a tiny amount of iron, 1%, 2%, 5%, 8%. And what was surprising by this result, Cannella, Meidos, Budnik, first of all, that there was a very sharp transition. People were expecting a non-sharp transition, in which you can see a very precise peak, a very sharp peak, and also that the transition does not disappear when you decrease the concentration of iron, but it just moves in position in temperature, and of course the signal becomes smaller, but that's quite natural because the amount of iron gives the signal. So if you decrease iron, the signal also decreases. Now, the first three-dimensional model from spin glasses was put forward by Edward Anderson 4 years after the Meidos experiment. And you have the Edward Anderson Hamiltonian, where you have some coupling between spins. Spins may be or Ising type or Ising one. For example, I consider Ising only, but it's clear how to move to Ising one. We have an external magnetic field, and the spins live on a lattice. The interaction is different from zero only from spin on the lattice, the interaction is a random sign, is positive or negative, and may be a Gaussian distributed or a binary distributed. It does not make no sense. So this type of model is a model that should capture most of the things that happens in the experiment. Now, the idea of Anderson, Edward Anderson, was that in this such a model, let's speak of zero magnetic field for simplicity, you can look to the local magnetization. At high temperature, you may have zero local magnetization. At low temperature, you have a non-zero local magnetization. This is well known in ferromagnets or in antiferromagnet. However, the idea is that each sample, just because it's characterized by random J's, will have a different value of the MI. So you cannot know in advance which direction where the magnetization points. However, the idea was to introduce as all the parameters characterize the transition, the average of the magnetization square, the average of the system. So the system will be characterized by Q Edward Anderson equal to zero at high temperature, and different frontier at lower temperature. Sherrington and Kilpatrick made an extra simplification going to mean field theory. In mean field theory, the typical model of mean field theory, you have all spin interacts one among themselves with an interaction among individual spin that is small. So it's been he feels the collective the area. And now you can expect that this model where all spins are connected gives the mean field theory on the model. Now, the first attempt of Sherrington Kilpatrick found something that was inconsistent. And after a certain amount of work, it was possible to show the solution of the model may be found introducing all the parameter Qx, where Q is some kind of generalization of the Edward-Anderson parameter, and where X is some parameter that is in the interval 0, 1. Now you see that the other parameter in this case is a function, and at the beginning the meaning of that parameter was mysterious. Now, a thing that was not clear at all at the beginning, which was the meaning of Q of X and the meaning of X. One could see from the formula that if Q of X were a constant, one would recover the original SK model, the SK solution, the central Kilpatrick solution. There were some hints on the meaning of having a non-constant Q. Now, one could argue that Q Edward Anderson was equal to Q1, while the suitability is given by this relation right there. Now, that was quite strange, because one could argue from the linear response theory that the suitability should be given by this relation, and that this relation is no more satisfied. Now, at the end of the game, what finally turned out that the spin-glass system has many equilibrium states. The state allowed by an index alpha, and each state happens with a probability W alpha. And each of the states is characterized by its own magnetization, and therefore, for a given system, one could define both an overlap matrix between the overlap between all different states and the W. And each sample has own matrix Q and also weighted W. Now the function Q of X essentially is describing the complex probability structure of the overlaps and of course of the weight W alpha. Now, one thing that at the end was clear, that you can define in spin glasses, also in many other systems, two susceptibility. I mean, what is the essential definition of the susceptibility? The magnetic susceptibility measures how the magnetization changes when you add a magnetic field. Now, the simplest things should be that could be done is to add a magnetic field at low temperature, and this gives what is the standard linear response susceptibility. I mean, you don't change the temperature, add a small, maybe slowly alternating magnetic field, and you measure the temperature, and the system remains in the same state. Now, if you add the other way to add the field, if for example, it to start from the high temperature, and we cool slowly the system. In this way, we measure the spin cool susceptibility, and one assume that the spin cool susceptibility is a proxy of that real thermodynamic susceptibility, because when we cool the system, one can argue that it remains in equilibrium state. No, the analytic formula gives the linear response susceptibility is just given as it should be by the old formula 1 minus Q R Edwards, but the field cool susceptibility, or better, the thermodynamic susceptibility, it was given by the other formula. So if Q is not constant, you should see that these two susceptibilities are different. And this means what happens in many, many systems, that the behavior of the system depends on the history of the system. Now, you can look for first all how the things behave in theory. And in theory, you see that there is this type of behavior at high temperature. You have the two coincide. When you go to lower temperature, the linear response susceptibility is essentially constant, while the thermodynamic susceptibility go to zero with the temperature. And now what is surprising is that these are the experiment in with real system with another I think that with manganesium called the manganesium system, and you see that there is the sharp peak of the standard susceptibility of the field of the linear response susceptibility, and you have a similar peak on but much smaller of the other susceptibility of the field cool susceptibility. And of course, this is not flat as this happens in this in the model, but has some peak also on the other side. But this is quite clear because this is it's a mean field, infinite dimension, and this is a real experimental three-dimensional system. So you see that this type of experiment give us some information, but however you get only this or only the key, or you get this other one, but you don't get the whole Q of X. Therefore, in the end, that we can measure Q of one for short time response, we can measure this integral from the long time response. But one would like to get a measurement to measure all the whole Q of X. Now it's clear that when, therefore, you need something that interpolate between short time and long time. Now you can ask short or long time respect to what? The solution of Coriolanus equation was very simple. Take care of the real experimental situation and let's discuss edging. Now, the idea is the following. Suppose that we really consider what happens in an experiment, that we take the system, we cool the system, and we wait a certain time before the system goes to equilibrium. And this is typical experiment. We cool the system, we may wait 10 seconds or 1 minute, 1 hour before starting. And let us measure the response function as function of the of these times, the times at which you start you add the magnetic field and the age of the system Tw. Now, usually one assumes that experimentally one assumes that it is not exact, but it's approximated that this susceptibility depends on the ratio T of Tw, but this is not quite important. Now, it's clear that now we have an extra susceptibility that we can measure. And the function R at time zero will be given the linear response susceptibility, and the function R at time infinity, the ratio infinity, will give the equilibrium susceptibility. However, this is at the minimum of the time, and it's not easy one would like not to enter in any detailed dynamic computation because we know that these are very complex. The idea of them here, Coulomb and Curzon, that you have another quantity that in principle you can define. The other quantity you can define is a correlation. The correlation that you look for, so it's sometimes W small, sometimes W large, I apologize. And here parenthesis is missing, sorry. Anyhow, for last time, you have you can measure this correlation function, and they essentially proposed that the derivative of the linear of the susceptibility with respect to time is related by function big X to the relation to the derivative of the correlation done with respect to the time. Essentially, if you at the end of the day, it's clear that you can eliminate dt from here. You can eliminate dt from here, and you arrive to a simple expression. And the idea was that for very large time, these things here is only function of the correlation C, and therefore this defines some idea of relation of fluctuation dissipation relation that should be valid at very large time. Now, the Coulomb recursion theory also predicts that this dynamically defined function is essentially equal to the static function. Therefore, this means that just because this function here can be measured in a real experiment, you can infer from real experiment this type of behavior, or the behavior X or Q. Now you have a lot of discussions that you can do because this essentially introduces a physical and effective temperature. There have been a lot of simulation discussing and so on numerical simulation, both in spin glasses and in real glasses and so on. So let me discuss here very briefly an experiment that has been done. The experiment will be done first all with a conventional system. I mean, a system which should not a complex system, which does not have a very off strange off equilibrium situation. And now you just take a copper rod and you have a squid. During the squid, you can do two things. So adding a standard magnetic field and measure the response theory or the relaxation. You can just look to spontaneous fluctuations of the magnetization, and this you get this result. Now you can plot the spontaneous fluctuation of the magnetization versus the correlations, and you find, as you expected, a simple straight law because x of c is the derivative of this function and x of c should be equal to one in this system. So this is a very elegant experiment in which you measure the temperature of the copper rod without touching it, looking only to the response between to the system, to a standard magnetic field and to another to enter the fluctuation or spontaneous fluctuation. So it's a good, very good test of the fluctuation dissipation theorem. However, if you do this kind of experiment, you with real spin glasses, is a quite different experiment that was quite long. It took more or less one year because you have to do many measurement in order to get the correlation, you find that something for the relation between the susceptibility and the response, the correlations and the susceptibility. Some of these are the real experimental data, which do not scale too much. They have some way to extrapolate to infinite time, because also if they have waited for 1 hour and 1 day, the data for one day are slightly different from those from 1 hour and so on, and also those from 1 minute. So they need some extrapolation to infinite time. And when you do extrapolation to infinite time, things look much better. However, this experiment was done 21 years ago. So one would like to get a better experiment these days. Now, the similar experiment can be done in different systems, glasses and so on. There's a lot of simulation that have been done in glasses. There are also real experiments which were done in Laponite, for example, in colloids. And one clearly sees that there is the same kind of plot now normalized with the response function versus the correlation. The things that one clearly see in this particular case that there is a strong effect of this response on the waiting time, and one has a feeling that when the waiting time go to infinity, I mean the waiting time is quite large here, the response that in the non-trivial part of the response is shrink to zero. Things there's not so many data on real glasses. Now, the thing that one would like to ask how these things can happen in the future, and now the idea that we can develop new techniques to perform this experiment in many other materials. In principle, my understanding is that there's no many data on structural glasses. Now, the real problem in this experiment is to measure the correlation. Now, the correlations is something that is not easy because you have to look to the magnetization or to some other quantity in glass to at time zero, a certain time, and another time. And you have to measure many times, 100, 1,000 times, if you want to get a low error. Now the point is that in principle, in glasses, you can use optical system, like it was done from colloids for Laponite, but as far as I know, but maybe I'm wrong, it's very difficult to measure the magnetization of a system with optically. Of course, one can invent something, and that would be very nice. And because if you do optical data, it's quite easy that you can move your laser beam, which is doing the measurement, very fast from one point to another point, and measure in this way the fluctuations in different points in nearly in simultaneous way. Now, it's clear that maybe you can maybe you can do something of this type on thin film, but that one has to discuss with experimentalists. Because it would be, however, it would be difficult ever to do in with bulk. Now, one possibility to use the same technique that is done in magnetoencephalography, that you can construct multiple squid for multiple samples, and you can put in you have multiple coils that take out the signal. Therefore, you could use some parallelism or 20 or things like that to get measurement of different samples, and that would be probably decrease the experimental time needed by a factor of 20. It would be important to do this type of experiment at easy, because if you do it easy, you can measure the function X or Q in different material. Now you can start to ask how the function X or Q is the different form of the function X or Q are related to different properties of the material, like memory, rejuvenation, and so on and so on. So it's clear that once also how these things depend from material. So it's clear that it will be very important to go from something that was done in some heroic effort, which took one year of data taking, or something that may be for a given type of material could be done in, let's say, in 2 weeks. Now, this will be extremely important. I think that from the last 20 years, there have been a lot of improvement in technique for doing SQUID or magnetic measurement. So I'm quite optimistic about that. The other problem that one can ask, you see that the data from the raw data that are presented here are quite different from the infinite time extrapolation. So one could ask, one can wonder how the results are extrapolated at infinite time. And now we understand the things much better. We understand things much better of how things may be extrapolated infinite time. Is something that has been done in very careful numerical experiment, where with a Janus computer, where we have measured some regions of relatively small times that goes from 2 to the 11 to 2 to the 26 Monte Carlo step, and as far as the Monte Carlo step correspond to or something of the order of a nanosecond, if you look in reality, this means that you have something that goes to some fraction of a millisecond to the tens of millisecond. So it's a quite small microscopic, but you have a very huge region. And also we can measure the static X or Q that can be measured in real sample. And one discovered that also the static X or Q or X or C that is measured in real in static measurement is something that depends on the volume. Now you see that there is a strong dependence of the volume. And this quantity, if as far as this quantity is concerned, we have a nice phenomenological theory to do the extrapolation to infinite volume. Now, if you, the other thing that happens, now we can do the same measurement that was done by Osho and others, and we find this point here for different waiting time. So we see a very large variation with time. And now this is also due because we do the measurement at on a small time scale, because we speak of fraction of a small fraction of the second from the to a few microseconds, while the Osho experiment was done for the minutes to the 1 day. And now, what you see that now the first type to compare, now you have these things here that you want to compare with that one in a quantitative way. And the first thing that you can say, well, the system has some, you can see that the system is somewhat thermalized to some length that depends on TW. Of the waiting time, at the waiting time, and you can compare now the function X of Q of the statics with the L that is a sense of the correlation length at the W with the dynamic things at the W. If you do this type of comparison, you see things are much, much better. You see the full line here that in this part here, the things is quite good, but you see that if you go in this direction here, especially which correspond to T much bigger than T waiting, things do not behave very well. You see a serious discrepancy between the theory and the numerical simulations. However, if you adjust the theory, the phenomenological analysis, saying that instead of comparing with a system with the L that is taken by TW, you say, well, the age of the system is T plus TW the moment that they've done the measurement, you see that everything is much better. This was the old way to do the comparison. Here is a new way to do the comparison, and you see that with these two changes, the old data in all region can be extremely well fitted. So we also understand in a very precise way how to do corrections to due to finite time, and therefore we can do much better of ocean that this passage from this behavior to raw data to in scale data. And therefore, I think that it would be a pity if we do not take profit of this fact to think a smart way to do measurement of this quantity in a smart way. Thank you so much. I ended. Pronto? Okay, I close. Okay. I don't hear you. I don't hear.
You don't hear?
Now I hear, yes.
Okay, fine. So, questions? Apparently, we're at the end of the day, no questions rising.
Okay.
After such a heavy day. Thank you very much, Giorgio. It's really a pleasure to have you here. Bye.
Welcome.
See you soon.